In this video, I will explain how you can generate the text of an email using Generative AI and SAS Visual Analytics. You will see how we can use GenAI, in this case Gemini, to generate text based on the data selected in a SAS Visual Analytics report. Before explaining how this can be done, I will demo the final report. The first step as an end user is to filter the data. In the report, I created multiple objects. The two drop-downs at the top are used to filter the data in the list object. And selecting a row in the list object will then populate our sent data to the data-driven content object at the bottom, which will generate the text of an email. If you change the language, in the language bar, it's sending a new request to the large language model, and it's then generate a new text. The text can be then copied and pasted into your preferred email editor and sent to your customer if you want. The purpose of the data-driven content object is to provide the needed structure to implement functionalities which might not be available out of the box, like calling web services which are external to SAS. The biggest difference with the web content object provided by SAS Visual Analytics is the data. The data-driven content object receives data from the report and can interact with other objects as if it was a native SAS object. Let's see how the functionality is implemented. The first step developing the web application is to get an API key from the GenAI provider. In this case, Gemini from Google. If you prefer to use ChatGPT or Mistral or any other large language model, the approach is pretty similar. For Gemini, I had to connect to the Google AI for Developers website and follow the steps described in the Gemini API Quick Start. The steps are straightforward and does not require prior experience. You can select the programming language of your choice. In this case, I selected the instruction for Node.js. The most important step is to generate the key. I will not demonstrate how to do it for obvious security reasons. There is, though, one thing to remember. You should copy the API key and store it somewhere. If you lose the key, there is no way to retrieve it. That means that you will have to follow the steps again to generate a new API key and disable the previous one. With that being said, let's move to the custom web application used by the data-driven content object. Building web applications can be done using different libraries or frameworks, and even languages. For the web application, I decided to use some of the most popular libraries nowadays. VJS, which provides the needed infrastructure to build the web application. It can be used to build web applications using different UI libraries. In this case, I chose React for the different components. In terms of look and feel, I chose Tailwind CSS, which eases the styling of the application using custom classes and making sure that the application looks the same regardless of the browser that you are using. When it comes to building web application, you should, of course, know HTML for the structure of your page, but you should also use another language to build the interactivity. In this case, I used TypeScript, which is a superset of JavaScript and brings type safety in the development process. Using TypeScript, you reduce the risk to get runtime errors related to data types manipulation. Let's move to the code. The application structure has been generated by VJS. In the env.local file, you should store the Gemini API key. This way, it will not be published to the Git repository when using GitHub or GitLab, and it will be secure. The main component of the application is the app file. This is technically the entry point for the end users. At the top of the app function, I've defined a few state variables for the application. I've then defined a fetch function, which will be used to call the Gemini API using the npm package provided by Google. On line 29, we define the prompts. The prompts will be used to generate the text. As you can see, we are passing data to the prompt value to make it dynamic based on the user choices. We then call the API and get the result. On line 59, we have another important element, which is the event listener. So we have defined this event listener to listen for data that we receive from the Visual Analytics report. This is how we collect the data, and we introduce these data in the prompts parameter for usage instead of the application. We then instruct the code to call the API whenever the prompts parameters or the language are updated. The last bit of the code is the layout of the application itself. It contains two elements, the language bar and the email objects. As you have seen in the demo, the language bar displays a list of languages, and under the language selection, there is nothing special in that object. It's just a list of languages that are displayed, and then the selection and how to handle the selection using the under click button. The same applies for the email. It's just a container which will display the text that is provided by the GenAI. That's it for the application. As you can see, the code is really small and it can be also found on GitHub. You can find more information in the documentation, but also the different blogs and their YouTube counterparts. Thanks for watching, and check back with the Technical Insight and Expertise series for additional tips.